My name is Jonathan Meads, and this series is called Even Further Abroad. It peels off the drab grey overcoat of preconception to reveal the lime green posing pouch of reality beneath.
What?
I remember it as if it was yesterday. But it didn't look like yesterday. It looked like tomorrow. I remember the future. It died a generation ago. Faith in the future, I mean. Faith in human ingenuity. In the solutions proffered by successive technologies. Other ages had human sacrifice, the sun, reason, chicken blood. Britain, in the third quarter of the 20th century, had bigness and newness. A newness which is now old, but which still prompts contemptuous wonder at the mix of technological prowess and moral naivety. Still prompts a longing for the sheer optimism and blind confidence. Still prompts a nostalgia for progress, no matter where it led.
Anything can happen in the next half hour.
I remember progress. Progress was the attrition of a name. Anthony Wedgwood Benn, Viscount Stansgate, mutated into Anthony Wedgwood Benn Commoner, who became Tony Wedgwood Benn. Then the Wedgwood went missing, and he was merely Tony Benn, a name which I further rationalised to one word, T-O-N-I-B-E-N. This is a Tony Bennometer, which measures the white heat of the relics of that revolutionary era when he was Minister of Technology. This registers 10 Tony Benns. Well done, Emily Moore! This is a television transmitter. It was, evidently, established by aliens in 1966, in order that 30 years later, this film might reach you. In the future, they looked forward, and they looked up, 1,265 feet up. This is the highest structure in Europe. They weren't to know that terrestrial communications will soon be overtaken by satellites and cables. Within a few years, this visible future will be a thing of the past. In its glory, the end of the Age of Progress, which had begun with the exponential industrialization of the 19th century, spawned monuments which were self-celebratory, bloated, grandiose, higher, highest, bigger, biggest. They shouted about the paramountcy of all technology. They proclaimed the victory of applied science. They advertised the coming of a new world. In the foundries of the technological revolution, there would be forged a social revolution. This is not merely a radio telescope in many parts. This is a beacon of Utopia UK, whose characteristic building form was big tech. The same big tech that would soon be built on the moon, on the clean slate of the planets. So we dreamt. Utopia UK was just the dry run for the galactic colonies of Brynylon and Teflon, which we are meant to be living in by now, but aren't. Installations such as Jodrell Bank scoured the heavens for colonial opportunities. It also aped the shape that we granted to aliens' transport. What is it with saucers? Has it something to do with the missing Wedgwood? Is that where it went? Utopia UK was several things. It was Fortress UK, the eastern outpost of the USA, the mighty USA, the specially related USA, home of the new, begetter of the big. Big Mac, Big Apple, Big Sur, Bigotry, Big Grand Coulee Dam, Big Rock Candy Mountain. Big...
balls.
America was home too of a populace which travelled hundreds of miles to witness the detonation of nuclear bombs in the Nevada desert. No one had warned them that tourism seriously damages your health. Far from it. Those poisonous mushrooms were so popular, their shape was reproduced as listening posts in Yorkshire. These are either giant agarics or they're mega zombies buried to the neck. Anything to keep the Soviets at bay. That was the ticket. The Cold War had its own reassurances, a surface simplicity being chief among them. There was only one enemy. It took up all the space reserved for animus. There was no room for ambiguity. Monolith squared up to monolith. Big sparred with big.
We've been up here now for nearly 30 years, haven't we?
Yes, and I think it's an intrusion into our beautiful countryside, this rather unnecessary sort of state of
eyesore. Eyesore is what you're really saying, that's right.
Absolutely, yes.
No, they don't mean that. They mean this.
They're putting just two fingers up to authority. The authorities really should be moving them on.
Well, it's a mess, isn't it?
Oh, the golf balls, oh, they're quite impressive.
I think they're really quite attractive.
The Cold War was a planetary board game, played with pieces as distinctive as those of chess or mahjong, pieces with a meaning incomprehensible to non-players.
Chicksands, far incidentally from any coast, recalls the armature of a druidical circus or the skeleton of a colosseum.
It possesses the quintessential big tech quality of unfathomable mystery, like Stonehenge or Karnak. What is Chicksands for? Where does it fit in the global game? Its paradox is that it's secret, but it's there for all to see. Indeed, its visibility and extent suggest that it was as much propagandist as belligerent. Some American Goebbels had thought to remind Little England who was looking after her. And of course, it is so big that any dog in space can spot it and report back.
Big tech's big pretense was that its appearance was sort of inevitable, that its appearance was due to technological expediency. The aesthetic was supposed to be a non-aesthetic. The kit recorded the way the kit worked. There was, it goes without saying, no attempt to blend in, no attempt to use adaptive coloration or camouflage, no attempt to be at one with the surroundings.
Strict geometry can be found in nature, but only with the aid of a microscope. When the natural world is seen by the unassisted eye, it is characterized by irregularity. Perfectly circular lakes, perfectly rectangular rock formations do not exist. Big tech pronounced mankind's dominion over the earth. It sought to ape Niagara. When we believed in progress, we believed too in humankind's supremacy. When we stopped believing in progress, we fell prey to grass liberation and sand welfare.
We became friends of the earth, friends of the water, which is folly, for it is to presume that the vegetable and the mineral are capable of receiving friendship, even of reciprocating it.
Friends of a wrong idea about the physical world, is more like it. Friends of a misconception about landscape. There's nothing natural about nature. The qualities that we revere in these acres belong entirely to mankind's intercession. Nature is always improvable. It needs man to shape it, to fashion its raw material. Patchworks don't just happen. What we're looking at here are human creations.
Follies are imposed on a landscape to catch the eye and to prompt delight. But they are typically whimsical. Gingerbread houses, exotic pavilions, sham castles. They satisfy an appetite for the cute, for the quaint, for the miniature. Wind turbines satisfy a very different appetite.
They satisfy an appetite for terrified awe, for the sublime. The sublime carries connotations of the transcendent. It alludes to mortality, to human puniness. We create this stuff, then measure ourselves against it and are found wanting. There is no comfort here, no coziness. Obviously, the sheer number is overwhelming, and repetition and symmetry add to the foreignness. Then there's the question of each individual turbine. It is a child's cheap toy bought in a waterwing shop on the front, held with glee. It's a child's toy inflated 100-fold. American sculptors like Oldenburg and Judd have proceeded in the same direction, in the land of the big. In England, land of the little, the procedure is reversed. No object which is reduced, scaled down, can fail to find favour. There is even a suburb, a full-scale suburb of Bournemouth, called Lilliput. There is not one called Brobdingnag. In the micro-universe of smallness and tweeness, everything has its place. A house looks just as a house should look. The miniature comforts because there's no puzzle attached to it. It is all immediately comprehensible, all immediately controllable. The miniature grants a false dominion, a make-believe power.
Gigantic is not comforting. We dread the response that it provokes. We suffer a national dread of awe.
And these are awesome machines, so vast, so powerful, that they make their own clouds in emulation of nuclear bombs. They create their own climate. These machines roar warnings of their energy, which is immense and violent and as driven as a hive's or an anthill's.
The very name of this place, Drax, would conjure up terror, even if we didn't know that Ian Fleming had appropriated it as the name of a villain. It might be Dracula's nickname devised by Tony Benn. The sheer size of it is a sort of embarrassment. The inclination is to ignore the cooling towers, and on no account to marvel at them.
They have to be cut down to size, reduced by simile. They're like bollards, like bongos, like the chimneys of buried forges. If something is forever like something else, it is never itself. This is another way of sweeping under the carpet that which cannot be literally hidden.
Who can ever forget the magisterial response of the former West Bromwich Albion footballer John Pruitt to a truly vast structure, the Great Wall of China? Mr. Pruitt spoke on behalf of the entire nation when he said, "When you've seen one wall, you've seen them all."
We've lived here about 24 years. We just take it for a matter of course. It's there. Two young men came and asked if I would talk to them. And I said, "What about?" And they said, the acid rain, which was affecting Norway. And they took my photograph with the power station in the background. And they also sent a photograph, which they said they would. But we couldn't make out what the article was.
Didn't know Norwegian.
We can't speak Norwegian.
Little England was never going to be hospitable to big tech.
It helped, of course, if structures, whether by chance or intent, recalled the human form. This is a nation which feeds its children books and films about railway engines which think and feel. This drivel is taken seriously. British capacity for escapist whimsy can never be underestimated.
So let us pretend that pylons are somehow related to us. Let us imagine that they're first generation robots made in our image. Here they stand, a capable human chain of reliable chaps bringing power to your home. It is no coincidence that they were designed by an intemperate opponent of modernism. It's not, of course, the case that Britain has turned to Luddism.
Far from it. We're helplessly dependent on the fruits of the technological revolution, but we scorn the utopian vision that they were meant to serve. We treat them as tools, not as sacrosanct icons of the white-hot ideology. The means have become separated from the morality. The means have also become commonplace. We take them for granted.
Today, a computer the size of a book can do what a computer the size of a house did a generation ago.
Big tech carried the seed of its own diminution.
In yesterday's tomorrow, no one thought small.
Because the natural order had been overturned, what went up did not necessarily come down. In Utopia UK, nurture got all the votes and nature none. Never mind the genes, feel the environment, which was a new word then. Perfectibility could be achieved by a constant supply of the correct buildings. This was called architectural determinism, and these were its laboratories.
If B.F. Skinner's rats responded to certain stimuli, then so might humans. Antisocial instincts might be obliterated by streets in the sky, concourses in the clouds, by forms of housing that did not take their cue from houses, but from the desire to stretch the limits of the possible, from the desire to make a tomorrow that broke with yesterday. These noble structures will survive as long as the castles they were often inclined to allude to. In the non-modern 90s, the most effective means of cleansing Little Britain of big tech has been to disguise it, to try and expunge the monolithic, to colour it as a child might. This is how we rewrite history, how we pretend the technotopia was never attempted. Big tech, far from changing the world, only worked when it was on its own ground. It was no party animal.
Big tech had, as was not said then, to define its own agenda, and it couldn't do this if it was cheek by jowl with the old. It didn't mix. It needed to be hermetic, total, comprehensive.
I'm head teacher here at Aylwin Girls' School, and I really love this tower block. I've got very fond memories because I was also here as a pupil during the 60s and early 70s, and I actually watched the building go up during the late 60s. It was built when the school expanded. Originally, the school was a small grammar school, and it was built to accommodate a large new comprehensive school. And I have to say,
the state's belief and investment in education must now seem idealistically profligate, hopelessly optimistic. From cradle to adulthood, the baby boomers' surroundings carried the promise of a new beginning, a fresh dawn, where the sun was so green with magenta polka dots.
No dessert. Oui, yes.
The university campuses built for boomers in the 60s are the most complete and thus probably the most successful exercises in big tech. Youthtopia enjoys a self-contained, autonomous environment. It is more controlled, more janitored than any new town.
It has the feel of an arcane fiefdom, a Sparta of denim and acne which has its own rights, rights which are in some measure determined by the singular geography and by the fact that the environment has to be learnt. And the student citizen learnt too that he or she was inhabiting a self-conscious, self-proclaiming work of art. Art, like education, was good for you. The sculptures which liberally litter the campuses emphasise the sculptural qualities of the utile structures.
And the utile structures declaim their top heaviness in an access of counter-intuition. Gravity is apparently defied as in a spaceship. Determinists could prove the rightness of their doctrine by creating places which so disoriented their inhabitants that they were bound to mould and shape in some way. Extreme environments do that. Prisons, submarines, barracks. Whether they do so without the discipline that pertains in those places is a different matter. But what is of moment is not whether behavioural changes were in fact effected. It is that the will existed to prosecute such experiments, and that that will was national policy. Despite the touchingly arrogant dogma of the right to fail, there was no expectation of failure. If the world moved forward, the world was succeeding. Marinate mankind in applied science for long enough, and even mankind itself would be put right.
Thank you.
What no one foresaw in that age of prospecting ahead was the swiftness of the reaction to its shibboleths. No one predicted the rejection of the very idea of progress. No one believed that fault would be found with the eternal flame of the white heat. But in the time it takes to say meltdown, nuclear power turned from friend to foe. Suddenly we wanted to turn back the clock, to coal fires, to the good old days of pneumoconiosis and emphysema. Nuclear power became a national bogey. Now we want our power sources to be natural, whatever that means. Rub two sticks together. We don't want big elemental shapes on the coastline, do we?
I do. I want these punctuation marks of human supremacy. And I've got some souvenirs of them. Cuddly nuclear souvenirs. Safe as houses, this gear. And what grandeur. Compare this might with the retro-puniness, which is today's future. This is today's future, decreed by the future king. We all subscribe to the scientifically baseless superstition that one family's blood is superior to that of all others. We honour the opinions, no matter how idle, no matter how boneheaded, of these accidents of birth. Thus this place, Pindbury, the Prince of Wales exemplar of the new model future, is sycophantically copied all up and down England. It sullies and it swallows up the green and pleasant. We've been here before, in the days preceding that brief and far-off parenthesis when Britain was modern. There's no longer anything left to visit, only to revisit. The shape of things to come is the shape of what's already been. We're invited to advance timorously into the past. My only choice is to conch out, to retreat into the future.